you know, through the course of 10 years of the magazine, we met a lot of a cool fishy kid around the South.
Welcome to another exciting episode of Fishing with Jay and Scoff, Southern Culture on the Fly. That's Dave Grossman yonder, Steven Seinberg yonder. We've been friends for a long time. We've had some ideas, some of them really bad. Some of them are pretty good.
Saw an ad on Craigslist. Free bad tattoos will be in the parking lot. I saw Jay and we met. I was getting my tattoo in the back of the Tacoma.
And right now we have the opportunity. We're in the most southern part of America, making a little woo.
Bottom of the whole country. South as we can go. A lot of water.
Talking about the South, Southern culture on the fly. We'll have some yaps with these guys and see if we can get down to the roots of it. It's an absolutely incredible magazine where they have inspired many a Southerner.
There's a language and a code to Southerners. They might be insulting you, but they'll be smiling while they do it, so you can't quite tell if you're being insulted. Grandma will tell you, like, oh, bless your heart. And you're like, did you just insult me, or are you really blessing me? Bless your retarded little heart. It's criticism with syrup. It makes it go down a little bit easier.
I'm not exactly positive what Southern culture is.
What do you call that thing?
I call it a court.
Okay. That's what we call it in the North, too. We call it a shouting court.
Community. You know, I've lived other places. You know, everyone tends to be a little bit nicer, take care of each other a little bit more than other places I've lived. Fried chicken. There's just no other place that has better fried chicken than the South. KFC is not fried chicken. Breakfast is good. You got like boils and pig pickings and a lot of food meant to get a lot of people together and hang out. For me, it was almost done with like a selfish motive of like, I just wanted the places I fish like to get like cool photography and writing to it, you know? And like let other people know how cool the shit all around us was. You didn't have to go out west to be like a serious fly fisherman. You can do it in East Tennessee, you can do it in Charleston, you can do it down here.
It's always been different too, that it's not a bunch of hero stories.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's truth. Neither one of us are the best fishermen in the world. And
speak for yourself.
It's not necessary for the stories that everything is perfect all the time and all the fish are caught. And I think people have responded to that, like the truth of it, that's the personality of it and all the other situations that it's in. It's not only about catching fish for everybody. And Dave, especially being in so many of the stories, doesn't portray himself as some fishing hero or know-it-all.
There haven't actually been a whole lot of big fish in the magazine. Like, there's been pretty pictures of fish. But it's not like we had a monster on the cover like every issue for 10 years.
We had really assumed that nobody but our friends would read it anyway at the beginning. And then when we started getting advertisers, we assumed that they would start leaving as they saw things they didn't like. And most of the responses we always got from them after was just keep doing what you're doing.
We've published stuff that we were sure we were going to get calls on a Tuesday from advertisers. We've only lost one advertiser over the year over content over the years. And we won't mention who they are, but yeah, that's pretty good. But they did not appreciate it, apparently.
I thought it was really good, but you know, what do we know?
I thought it was quite artistic. Most of the best part of the magazine has been just getting to know everyone we've gotten to know through it.
And all the gold, money, yeah, the exorbitant riches.
Yeah, the Ashkenazi gold.
Yeah.
It's the shiniest.
I mean, we've had a ton of people and a lot of talented people, you know, to work with us.
Mm-hmm. Talented people and Dave.
And Dave. And we also had Dave. Who is David Grossman? I don't know. I'm sure beer's involved, though.
There's nothing wrong with a cold beer on a hot day. Or 12 or 14 of them, if you can handle it.
I can. I can handle one for every 12 of yours. Kind of amazing, really. He's capable of doing things that most humans are not.
in 2021, Dave lost his wallet three separate times on three separate trips.
In a row. I like making messes.
That's probably partially it.
Oh, they got pockets.
Dave's voice that attracted the other people, because I think that that's kind of where the magazine really bases from.
Rob him for the win.
It's kind of his voice.
This is all cotton, baby. Linen.
It's very loud.
I gotta get around this hump first.
You can hear him from anywhere on the water.
Right there. I just wanna get around this side.
And when you're in a car with him for long periods of time, if you don't open the window, you'll get based out by his voice.
Dave Grossman, I got a question.
Yeah.
You're the king.
What would you do if you were king of the world?
If I was king of the world, I would eliminate the salutation pipelines.
Yeah, is that decree number one?
Decree number one.
I'm organized when it comes to building houses, like what I do for my other job. I like kind of my fishing to be disorganized, as far as like, I'm pretty easygoing. So whatever happens is gonna happen anyway. There's no need to worry about it. I would say with fishing stuff, Steven is more organized.
Fishing stuff, what do you mean?
I mean, your fly tying stuff is always neater than mine. You always know where all your rods and reels are and all like the sleeve, rod tubes and sleeves for them. And like you have all the original like neoprene cases for your reels.
Okay, I'll give you that.
Steven?
Yes?
I have a serious question for you.
Okay.
If you were king of the world, what would you do?
Well, that's quite a question. I would not want to be king of the world. That's not my style.
I've been painting for 30 years or more. I've always made art, and these romp-ums are not that comfortable, David.
Steve Seinberg. Old Steve. Well, he's older than me. We should start there. Like the uncle that was cool that would pass you the doobie or take you to the dead show when you were a little kid. Father, photographer, my little pal Stevie.
Photography was something I started with, and I started wanting to not really work on things that were already there. I kind of wanted to make up my own. I felt like maybe that was limited by photography, and so I started making sculptures. And somehow, making sculptures, I realized that I still wanted it to be flat.
I have a query.
Oh yeah?
Were you scared of the third dimension?
I was not scared of the third dimension.
Like, it's too much, it's too real. And
I just liked the idea of, in photography, I like to photograph on the wall. I like the fact that you were looking into this two-dimensional space. I knew I wanted to make art, and I just didn't know, maybe I just didn't know what my medium was. And I started painting.
Steve is also a world-renowned modern abstract painter, shown in galleries and museums around the world. Tell me if I'm wrong. Big modern abstract pieces, you know, very kind of subtle, as far as shapes and form go, and color, as far as palette goes, but very layered, where the more you look at it, the more you realize you're seeing within the subtlety of it. Often relating to the natural world, where he enjoys himself most. When we were living in Asheville, Steve was doing a lot more like trout stuff, like caddis pupa and rocks on the bottom of the river, and now that he's moved to Florida, that's a lot more mangrovey, you know, grass.
A lot more references to lagoon, yeah, lagoon.
But always around water.
A lot around water.
How'd I do, Steve?
That was pretty good. That captured a lot of it.
For a layman, just a black and white cookie of balance, my friend.
It's kind of a lot around, like, relationships, so the relationships and within like systems, and so you could say like, you know, water, you know, has its systems and symbiotic relationships, and human beings have their systems and intimate or symbiotic relationships. And
look at the teamwork though.
So a lot of my work kind of references that.
Pretty handy on a push pole. Doesn't know how to row a drift boat and refuses to learn. God, I want these fish so bad. Please, God, catch one.
Scuff comes together at the last moment.
There was a possibility giving the South a little bit more, and with all these other people around us, it wound up turning into a lot more people attracted to it, I guess. And because of that, that's how we met you. That's how we met and were able to work with a lot of the other people that have contributed and written for and photographed and painted and drawn and made films and stuff for the magazine and all this part of the same community.
Here's my thing when we started it was, like, when you read, like, and no, I'm not trying to throw shade on print, like old print magazines like Fly Fisherman, American Angler, and the same editors when I was a kid aren't there now, so it wasn't their deal anyway. But when you saw those magazines growing up, it was always like some monster on hero shot, you know, of BC steelhead or Cali steelhead or whatever. And you, when you start fly fishing, you quickly realize, like, that's not the reality of the situation. It's awesome when it happens to you like once or twice in a normal human's life. But like, you can have just a, like, the fun of it is this, like hanging out with your buddies. Like if you get a fish today, awesome. If you don't, it was still better than doing something else. Like everything's not like biggest always wins, you know what I mean? You know, from a fishing standpoint, like it's given me the opportunity to do a bunch of cool stuff that, you know, I wouldn't have necessarily done without it. I would have probably just stayed guiding and stayed on my tailwaters and stayed dialed on that and not really gotten out and done much else.
Cuda Abdum.
It kind of showed me that there's definitely like an up and coming generation of, you know, Southern kids fly fishing, which is good to see. Because, you know, for a while back then, like what, 5-6 years ago, there was all kinds of worries about recruiting the next generation, which I don't think the job is done, but you know, through the course of 10 years of the magazine, we met a lot of a cool fishy kid.
Why does it look so mean? Max, you should have a word with it. Maybe say something sweet to it.
Right in front of his face.
There's another one right behind him.
It has been a lot. It's been good though. I'm proud of it. The creative effort, that's the part I'm proud of. Like, I think we put together interesting stories with good images and from a variety of people that had like a great voice. I'm proud of the way it looks. I'm proud of like the way it reads. I'm proud that it's different than everything else.
I don't know, in 41 issues, even with everything else we got going on in our lives, family and work, we've never put out an issue where we're like, man, we kind of phoned it in on that one and it kind of sucks, you know? Like everything we've put out, we've both been proud of, which I think if you ask any magazine person that's done the same magazine for 10 years, I'm not sure you would get the same answer. You know what I mean? Like more, we've never had just filler that we threw in there just to fill. Like everything was always like coming from a creative spot and mainly like a lot of stuff that we just thought was funny.
I'm glad people liked it. I'm glad people read it. I think that the stories and things we've had in there are just not the same kind of thing that people normally read in fly fishing magazines. And I just think we've done something different that just is, I think, for a whole group of people that were bored with what was there.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd agree with that.
100, dude. Just... That's what it is, you know? It's kind of home.
Home.
And then I go a lot of other places, and then I come back to the South. Where I like it.
Oh, man, are you kidding me?
Steve, shake that ass. There you go.
Put my fishing uniform on. Alright, show me those fish again.
I believe they refer to this as a romp him instead of a romp her. And I am ready to romp.
This is not the most comfortable fishing uniform, but maybe if we made it out of something else.
Dude, I think if I opened up these armpits, like free air flowing, and they wouldn't be a pinch point, I could definitely do this. One, two sizes bigger, I'd be money. Nice.
He ate.
Yes, he did.
Another good reason we started the magazine was because we knew if we made a little bit of money, our wives would tolerate us
fishing more.
Fishing more. Because it was part of the magazine. And that whole lie lasted, they believed that for like, what, 2 years?
Years.
You're basing Southernness on foraging skills.
No. Well, that has something to do with it.
It does have something to do with it.
Last Radio Shack in the country.
Long grown season.
I'm not convinced there are any fish in the Keys.